I'm Ben, and this is Hyperfine, Resources and Tutorials for Architects by Architects. This is part two of my How to Build and Why to Build Your Own Computer for Architecture School. I just put this computer together yesterday, and I wanted to share how I chose the different components that went into it and how I put the whole thing together. So part one talked about the reasons why you should build your own computer. This video is going to be about how. So I'm going to list all the components individually. I'm going to talk about different compatibility issues, things to look out for, specifications to be aware of when you're choosing parts for your own computer. And then toward the end of the video, I've got a time lapse of actually putting the whole thing together so you can see what the actual process is. You can also read more about it on hyperfinearchitecture.com. Check out the blog page, and of course, check out the resources page for free architectural resources. If you like this video, if you find this helpful, please like and subscribe, and definitely leave a comment if there's something you guys want me to cover next. Thanks for watching. Okay, here are the components for the computer I'm going to be assembling today. I'll talk quickly about what each one is, why I chose them, and some compatibility issues. I think the number one thing to be aware of when you're assembling a computer and buying the parts is compatibility. You can't just choose each individual part by itself. Everything has to work together, and so whether it's the shape, the size, the connections, the interface, there's lots of different compatibility points that you have to be aware of. You have to start somewhere. A lot of times people start with the processor that they want. Your two main choices are Intel or AMD, and then within that there's plenty of different models. This is an Intel Core i7, so it's a powerful processor. There's more powerful ones on the market. There's also less powerful ones where I could have saved money. I've always used Intel for all my workstations. For my render nodes, I've tended to use AMD, where you can typically get more cores for a little bit less money. If you are going to get into rendering, I highly suggest getting an i7, either a quad-core or a six-core. i7s have something called hyper-threading, which allows one core to act as two. If you are not going to get into rendering, you can save some money here with your processor by getting an i5. One of the most important compatibility issues with your processor is the socket type. You see this is LGA 1151. The socket type refers to the shape of the processor, how it connects to the motherboard. So if you choose, in this instance, a Core i7 with a LGA 1151 socket type, you have to get a motherboard that is 1151 socket type as well. Here's the motherboard. Okay, here's the motherboard. I've unboxed it. You can see the motherboard basically holds everything together. All the components you get are going to plug into the motherboard, and this will be the interface between basically yourself and your computer. You see you've got the socket here, it's covered up, that's where this processor will go. We've got some RAM slots, we've got a slot to install a graphics card. In the back you've got your different USB connectors, audio connectors, that type of thing. There's different power ports on here that could connect basically to the power. So your motherboard, the compatibility issues here are first and foremost the socket. You have to get a socket, a motherboard with a socket that matches your computer. And then the size. You can see this is a pretty small one. This is called a mini ITX. There's lots of different form factors, but you will have to choose a form factor that matches your case. So my case back here is an MITX sized case, so I have to get a motherboard that's this size. You can see this is pretty small. I do give up some features by having a motherboard this small, such as I only have two RAM slots, where larger motherboard could have four or more. I only have one slot for a GPU, but the trade-off, the benefit that I was looking for is a small case that I can sit on my desktop. So make sure that your motherboard has the correct socket, and then choose the size you want. And when you're choosing the size, you have to coordinate that with your case. All right, the next thing we'll talk about is storage. So a common trend now is to have multiple different storage drives in your computer. You will a lot of times see in gaming computers a smaller solid-state drive and larger storage capacity typical hard drives. So this is an M2 solid-state drive. M2 refers to the form. It's this little, it's this small form. And this is capable of PCIe speeds. You want to also check compatibility with your motherboard, that it has an M2 slot, and that it can make full use of the speed. There's lots of videos about how to do that on YouTube. So this storage drive is about 256 gigabytes, and it is incredibly fast compared with the traditional hard drives, which have a rotating disk. So when I set up my computer, I'm gonna load Windows onto this drive. I'm gonna load all my programs, Revit, Photoshop, 3ds Max. So when I launch programs, it's going to happen, you know, almost instantly. Then for storage for all my files, you know, my music, my pictures, all that stuff, I'm going to install these standard hard drives. This is a 2 terabyte hard drive, and I've got two of them. I'm going to install them in a setup called RAID, which allows, it's sort of like a built-in safety. So even though I have two hard drives, you would think, and each one's 2 terabytes, instead of actually getting 4 terabytes of storage, I'm only going to have two, but I'm going to have a built-in backup. That is completely optional. The computer I have downstairs just has one hard drive, and it works fine. But this is a very common setup you'll see nowadays. All right, the next thing is your RAM. This is your memory. There's another compatibility issue here. You've got to make sure that the size and speed are compatible with your motherboard and your processor. This is DDR4 288-pin RAM, which is probably one of the most common form factors on the market today. You'll see most of your motherboards are going to support that. You see I've got two sticks of 8 gigabytes each for 16 gigabytes of RAM. One thing to note about RAM, if you think you're going to want more in the future, it's always good to get 8 gigabyte sticks. My computer downstairs has 4 slots for RAM, and when I initially purchased the RAM, I wanted 16 gigabytes. Instead of getting 4 sticks of 4, I got 2 sticks of 8. That way I could easily upgrade in the future, which I did by adding 2 more sticks. If I had, say, bought 4 sticks of 4 for 16 and I wanted to go to 32, I would have had to replace all 4 of those sticks. Instead, I left 2 slots open, and when I had a little bit more money, I just went and bought those other 2 sticks of RAM. All right, the next component we'll look at is your power supply. And I think every video I've seen about putting a computer together says the same thing. You don't want to skimp on your power supply. You want to get a good, efficient power supply. It'll protect your computer. Look for an 80 plus rating. This is 80 plus gold. They come with different levels. I think there's silver, gold, platinum. And you can also look for a modular. So there's standard, semi-modular, and fully modular. And what fully modular means is if we look at the actual power supply, back here is where all the power cords plug in that are going to go from the power supply to the motherboard and to the different components on the motherboard. With fully modular, you can see that they're not installed. They're sitting down here on the side, and I can only install the ones that I need to use. If you get a standard power supply that's not modular, all these cables are going to be hardwired in and you can't remove them, even if you don't actually need them for the build you're doing. So a fully modular power supply can save you space in your computer. It definitely helps keep your build cleaner by removing extra wires that you don't need. Okay, earlier when I talked about the processor, I forgot to mention a CPU heatsink fan. But basically, when you get a boxed processor, all you're getting is the processor. And when you do your build, you need to install a cooler directly on top of that processor to remove heat. A compatibility check here, you have to get one that is compatible with your motherboard. You can see in your motherboard, there's going to be some holes around the CPU socket for installing your heatsink fan. So you have to make sure you're getting one that's compatible with your motherboard socket type. Other things to look for is the form factor. You can see I'm using a small case, so I got a small form factor CPU heatsink fan. And then you're gonna need to get some thermal paste. This stuff came with the cooler. You can also get some stuff called Arctic Silver. I think that's far and away the preferred product to use for CPU heatsink fan. Okay, only a couple of pieces left. You can see one major thing that I don't have on the table here is a graphics card, basically a video card. That's because the one I'm gonna use is still sitting in my computer downstairs. That's a major expense in your build. It's a major component. In this build, I decided to save a little bit of money by using one that I've had that's only about a year old, but that will be something that you have to coordinate with your case, especially if you're getting a smaller case. You gotta make sure you don't get a graphics card that's too small. All right, just a couple more things. One is your operating system. This is an annoying thing to have to buy, but you need an operating system to run your computer. This is Windows 10. You can see this case doesn't have any external bays, any external drive, so this case is not gonna have like a Blu-ray player built in, but because this Windows is on a disk, I need to have a spare CD drive ready that I can plug in during the install. Another accessory that I have that you will need are some case fans. You need to keep air moving through your case. There will be different size fans that are compatible with your case. So in this case, I've got a couple 80 millimeter fans that will go in the rear that help pull air through. And then I've got this one large fan that the case actually comes with one already, but this one has green LEDs, so you gotta look good too. And the final thing, which is an accessory, but I think it should be standard, is a backup hard drive. These things are inexpensive for a lot of storage. There's no reason not to have your work backed up. You can see in this case, for this build, I'm having my two drives in RAID as one form of backup, and I'm having a external drive as a second form. So I'm protecting all my work that I've done so I don't lose anything. This is 4 terabytes for maybe about $100. You can't beat it. Okay, so those are all the parts that are going into this build that I'm about to put together. I have put in a little bit more detail about why I chose each one on the blog. Check out hyperfinearchitecture.com for free architecture resources. And now I'm going to put this thing together. I'm going to do a time-lapse video, and I'll probably add some notes along the way to point out important items and important things along the way during the build. So check it out, and thank you for watching. Okay, I'm just about to start the build. Just a couple things I forgot. Number one, probably the most important thing in your entire build is your motherboard manual. This is going to tell you where all the connections have to go. It's going to tell you how to install things. Spend a lot of time reading this. Refer to it often as you're doing your build. You're also going to want a static guard. I'll put a complete parts list in the description and on the blog. But this is to prevent any electrical static you have from being discharged into the computer. And you're also going to need a monitor, a keyboard, and a mouse. Okay, let's get started. Okay, the heatsink fan is installed. You don't want to tighten it too tight, but a nice snug fit on those screws. And now the heatsink fan is installed, and I can plug the power header right here into where it goes on the motherboard. Okay, I got my graphics card. I just took this out of my old computer downstairs, and this is a GTX 960 with 2 gigabytes. There's definitely more powerful cards on the market right now, but graphics cards at this moment are sort of at a high price point. So I'm gonna wait for them to go down a little bit before I upgrade. This thing is maybe 18 months old, so it's still perfectly capable. And I know it's gonna fit on this motherboard and in my case. Now I can start plugging cables in. You can see this is modular, so I only plug in the ones that I need to use. Okay, so I've got my processor, my heatsink fan, I've got my RAM and my graphics card installed. I've got it all connected to the power supply. That's turned on. So what I need to do now is try to boot the computer. There's some pins on here in the back that you can't see. It's actually even hard for me to see. They're not labeled that well, but these will connect to the power button on the case. Since I don't have it installed, I just use a screwdriver to short those two pins. And you see it spins up. Hopefully it will turn on the screen and we will get some indication that the computer is working. And I forgot to install the power to the graphics card. This is the BIOS. This is basically where I can change settings on the power supply, or I'm sorry, on the motherboard in the computer itself. And we get indication of the processor, the processor speed, the total memory. It's showing 16 gigabytes with 2 sticks, so that looks good. Showing me the speed of the CPU fan and some other system settings. But for now, this is good, so what I'm gonna do is start installing my solid state drive, and I'm gonna put the thing in the case. I'm installing the M2 drive. The M2 drive is M2-2280. What it means is M2 is the general form factor. It's this stick form. 2280 is the length in millimeters. So you've got to make sure your motherboard has screws at the right length. And there's plenty of them in here. It's listed on the motherboard how you all install it. Or it's listed in the motherboard manual. I just read that. So now I'm going to go ahead and install the M2 drive. Okay, so I've got my solid state drive installed, and for a couple reasons, I'm going to install the operating system now. I think it's going to be a lot easier for me to do while this thing is all outside the box. Also, I don't want, it's not really a easy mistake to make, but I just want to make sure there's no chance that I actually install the operating system on my hard drives. So I'm going to install it now while the M2 drive is the only thing installed. So basically I need to take my my CD drive, connect it to the power supply, connect it to the motherboard, then run through the Windows install just like you normally would. Once that's done, then I'll start building everything inside the case. So I completed the build. You saw I messed up a couple times. That happens. You can see I've got a mess of cables in here, which I'm going to have to clean up and use zip ties to make it look nicer. But for now, the build is complete inside the box, so I'm going to turn it on and see if it works. And if it does, then I will come back when I've got it all cleaned up and the box all put back together. And it works. That's a really, really satisfying feeling, guys, to actually put something together and have it work. You saw with the solid state drive how quick Windows loaded. So this build is 90% done. I've got to clean up the cables, put the side panels back on, and then go spend a lot of time loading up all my software. All right, and here's the final product. I've got the computer completely reassembled inside the case. I've got the cables somewhat cleaned up. So I get a nice clean view of the LEDs and keeping the processor heatsink fan nice and clear. And now I'm ready to go install all my software and use this as my primary computer.